Please join me in welcoming Dr. Sam Telford.
I'm delighted to see so many faces here. In fact, you all beat Carlisle. I spoke at Carlisle last year, there are many more people here than there were there. And I'm absolutely delighted also to see the extent of the educational materials that are available to you. And in fact, if you were to learn and read them and learn them thoroughly, you wouldn't need people like me to come and tell you what you need to do to reduce your risk. And so what I want to do tonight is review the elements of your yard, of the environment, that place you at risk. Where did this thing come from? Where did this epidemic of tick-transmitted infections come from? If you understand that, then you might be able to intervene. That is, use that knowledge to reduce risk at the personal, community, and regional level. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on disease. I'm not a physician. I do study disease, and I'm happy to answer questions to the best of my knowledge. But what I want to try to do is sort of paint a picture of hazard out there in the environment on a general scale. That is, during the summer, we have what's known as summer fever. Some people call it fever of unknown origin, flu-like illness, and it comprises a syndrome with one or more of these signs and symptoms, fever, chills, achiness, joint pain, sweats, fatigue, prostration, nausea, stiff neck, but the important part of it is that there is no runny nose or other respiratory sign associated with this summer fever. Well, what's the cause of this summer fever? Lyme disease is one of them, but it's one of only 11 possible diagnoses associated with tick-transmitted infections. So with deer ticks, and there are one, two, three, four different kinds of ticks locally that will attack humans, although some are more common than the others, we all know about deer ticks. That's pretty much why we're here tonight. And they transmit 5 different infections here in Massachusetts. Lyme disease, everybody knows about. Fewer know about Borrelia miyamotoi disease. We described that in a report in the New England Journal last January. January of 2014, January of 2013. It'd been under our nose all along, and we were fortunate enough to be able to actually attribute infection to that. We now know that it's fairly common, maybe one case of BMD to 30 cases of Lyme disease. Babesiosis used to be restricted to the coastal areas, and in particular Martha's Vineyard, Nantucket, and Cape Cod, and now has increasingly been found across much of the state. And that is an infection that is very different from all of these others in that it's due to a protozoal infection. It's a malaria-like in its biology and presentation. Another bacterium, human granulocytic ehrlichiosis, some people call it anaplasmosis now, is also transmitted by deer ticks, probably the second most common infection transmitted by deer ticks after Lyme disease, also causing fever, headache. In fact, headache is the cardinal feature. If you have a headache that doesn't go away with an analgesic like aspirin or ibuprofen or naproxen, that one should be top of the list in terms of the differential diagnosis. And then finally, an infection that I found back in 1997, and gave up after a while of asking my physician friends to send me samples from patients with fever, chills, muscle aches, stiff neck, and maybe a fever that goes away and comes back. More recently, within the last 5 years, we've recognized as being a human pathogen, deer tick virus or deer tick encephalitis. This is the one that's recently gotten notoriety in the Hudson Valley, where they've had 14 cases over the last 3 years with five fatalities. It's related to a severe and probably the most severe infection in Eurasia, tick-borne encephalitis, and it's one of those that requires the need of a spacesuit facility to work on. So this is around, it's common in ticks, and we're just starting to appreciate its distribution in the Northeast. Dog ticks used to be the tick. Prior to the 1970s, some people who are old enough will remember this is what you found in the woods, is the dog tick. And at that time, it was known to transmit Rocky Mountain spotted fever, which, strangely enough, has disappeared pretty much, and we don't know why. And in fact, dog ticks themselves are becoming scarce because they depend upon the name is a misnomer. It used to be maintained by dogs in people's yards, but now people are using things such as Frontline and Advantage and all the topicals. They're not reproducing on dogs anymore, which means that they're dependent upon skunks and raccoons. And then distemper and rabies comes through and eliminates skunks and raccoons for years at a time, and the tick population can't handle it. So it's going locally extinct in many places. I have a hard time finding good populations of them. Out on the vineyard, we have an infection called tularemia, otherwise known as rabbit fever. We won't talk about that. It's very, very rare here in Massachusetts other than Martha's Vineyard. Lone star ticks are a new invader. They're the most common tick from New Jersey down south all the way across to Texas. They are extremely aggressive. They have eyes. They're fast. They think nothing of moving from here to the front row in pursuit of a blood meal, unlike dog ticks or deer ticks, which are ambush predators. They sit on the vegetation and wait for you to come by. These guys, the lone star ticks, will come right after you. Fortunately, the only populations I know that are established are in the South Coast region, Cuttyhunk Island and Nashuina Island, Prudence Island in the Narragansett Bay. However, sporadic specimens are found virtually everywhere across Massachusetts, and it's only a matter of time before they become established, and then we really have a problem. Because they transmit at least three different infections, probably five, and they're completely different from those transmitted by deer ticks. And in fact, the poor people in New Jersey have to deal with deer ticks, dog ticks, and lone star ticks all the time, and they have most of these, 10 different ones, 10 different infections to deal with. Woodchuck ticks, you rarely see. They're mostly down in the burrows of woodchucks, but if a woodchuck dies and you're playing around the entrance to the burrow, you might be bitten. And there's perhaps the most dangerous virus in North America, Powassan virus, which is related to deer tick virus. There have been maybe 30 or 40 cases known in the literature, mainly from Ontario and upstate New York. There we have a high case fatality rate. Maybe 30% of the people who get it die. And there's no treatment, there's no vaccine, there's just not much we can do other than avoid tick bites. And so these are all around us. And so when a physician is confronted with this fever of unknown origin, it could be any of these things. And in fact, one of my jobs is to look for these, what I call agents demonstrated to exist in human biting ticks, but there's no connection yet to human disease. We need to write a case report to incriminate them as an agent of disease. And then other things that we know are present in these ticks in the upper Midwest, but I haven't found them here yet. I will, but I haven't found them yet. So why have deer ticks replaced dog ticks in our psyche in the last 30 years or so? And in particular, the 1970s appeared to be when some sort of threshold was reached in the environment in New England. So distilling down a huge body of literature, we can come up with three large-scale effects that have led to the rise of the deer tick in New England. One is the change in the landscape. I don't have to tell you that once upon a time, we chopped down the forest. It took 18 cords of firewood to heat an average home prior to the advent of gas or electric furnaces or oil furnaces. Those farms were abandoned in the 1920s and 30s, and we've seen our landscape return, so-called secondary or successional growth. So the picture on the right I have no pointer. The black and whites on the right show Nantucket Island on Pulpus Road in 1880. And the picture down below was done by the Audubon Society. Oh, that'd be great. the Audubon Society. Oh yeah, it's an LED. The Audubon Society in 1985, where the exact same vantage point was identified by compass from landmarks. And so we have this very thick, brushy habitat that sprung up where once there were no trees. The top picture would not have supported deer ticks. Any pasture that you have would not support a lot of deer ticks. You might find some, but nothing like what you would find in the woods. The reason is this tick is very susceptible to drying out. It requires a relative humidity of 85% or greater at the level of the leaf litter, and it needs this continuously. So tonight, the relative humidity in this room is maybe 30, 40% at the most. If I were to bring a jar of ticks here that had holes punched in it, small enough so that they wouldn't get out, but enough so that there'd be air circulation, so I bring them from my lab, I put them on the table. When we came back here tomorrow at the same time, half of them would be dead. So drying out kills these ticks, and so pasture would not have supported ticks. You have the sun beating down on very short grass, but now we have this very thick habitat. Not only that, where are the animals gonna hide in the pasture? You don't have large populations of mice, in particular the white-footed mouse or the shrew, which the deer tick likes to feed on. So we've created this habitat perfectly for the deer tick. I also don't have to tell you that we've increased our use of these habitats. We developed them. We put our houses right up into the woods. We go and we hike in the woods. We're exposing ourselves to what's in these new woods, these newly regrown woods. And then finally, we've allowed the deer to come back. Once upon a time, there were deer. With the disappearance of the forests and hunting by settlers as well as the Indians, the deer disappeared. And it was unregulated hunting. But once hunting was regulated, they're a resilient animal, they came back, and now they're just as common in your garden as a chipmunk. So those are the three main factors that led to the emergence of the deer tick transmitted infections, the deer ticks and the infections that they carry. And I'll come back to this slide because it tells us a little bit about what we might be able to do to bring the landscape back to what it was before the 1980s. When here, you didn't have a problem. You didn't have a problem here 10 years ago. But you need to understand the life cycle of the deer tick. And we'll start in spring, up at the right corner there, because hopefully spring is coming. The adult tick is the stage of the tick that's out now. So there are four stages to the tick. There's eggs, larvae, nymphs, and adults. The adults are the only ones that reproduce. The adult ticks, and they all have their specific season of activity. The adult ticks are around from October until the end of May. Even now, there are probably places, if you were to find a place that didn't have a lot of snow on it, and walk through there today, you would have picked up ticks. If it's too cold for you to be out without gloves for more than about 10 minutes, it's too cold for the ticks to be out and active, because they're not warm-blooded. They're ambient temperature. And so when it's too cold, they just sort of shut down and hide in the leaf litter. So the adult ticks are out. They're looking for a large animal to feed on. They'll feed on foxes. They'll feed on dogs. They'll feed on people. They'll feed on bear or coyote. But the thing that's around most in these woods that the deer ticks seem to find is deer. And there's also some evidence that they like deer, that there's a tropism, that they actually home in on deer and their smell. So if they find a deer and they feed successfully, the female will take a large blood meal, drop off, and then hide somewhere. We don't know, probably the leaf litter somewhere. And it will lay eggs as it starts warming up in the late spring and early summer. And those eggs will hatch synchronously in mid-July. It doesn't matter whether the tick took its blood meal in April, or it took its blood meal back in October. That's the same generation. They all hatch in mid-July. We don't know why. And the larvae, the baby ticks, emerge from those eggs and look around for something within an inch of the ground. They'll feed on, the white-footed mouse has gotten the rap in terms of feeding most of them. They feed on birds that forage on the ground. They feed on shrews, chipmunks, squirrels, you name it. But in general, in most years, the white-footed mouse is the most common animal messing around the leaf litter where these baby ticks are. The baby ticks or larvae feed July, August, September, then they disappear. If they fed successfully, they probably drop off in the leaf litter or in the mouse nest and rest there until it warms up in the spring. So starting about now, as the temperature starts to climb, development of ticks is regulated by temperature. So as it warms up, the developmental rate increases rapidly. So by the end of May, all of the larvae that fed back in August and September of last year have now developed into nymphs, the teenager stage of the tick. They're out May, June, mid-July, and then they pretty much by mid-July, they're gone. Some of that is related to weather. That is, if it's hot and dry, it's just too hot and dry for them, they die. So if you have a hot and dry June, you'll see fewer Lyme disease cases. So they'll feed, again, they'll feed on anything. They'll feed on you, they'll feed on mice, they'll feed on birds, they'll feed on deer. But generally, whatever's down where they are. And that's where you pick them up. You're walking through leaf litter, you're brushing up against low-lying twigs. You may be gardening and putting your hands in places where the ticks are. So they're feeding during this time, May, June, July, and if they feed successfully, they use that blood to develop into the adult stage, and then they seek hosts in October again. So it's at least a two-year life cycle. At any given point, when there are nymphs around, the larvae are around somewhere, right? The eggs are developing and will turn into larvae later on. The adult ticks have disappeared, and then the nymphs will turn into adults. And so that has an important connotation to control. What do we do? What if we spray only once a year? You might get the stage that's active, but there may be a couple other stages hidden away from the spray. What is greatly misunderstood, and it's controversial out there. It hasn't evolved to the point where we're throwing chairs at each other, but people like me duke it out with other scientists in what is the most effective way to reduce environmental transmission, that is, to try to break the cycle. Some say it's mice. Oh, mice are everything. Well, the fact of the matter is, Lyme disease, spirochetes, the bacteria that cause Lyme disease, in order to get from one generation to another, needs two things. The first is the actual tick. It can't go anywhere without ticks. So you need to produce ticks. And that means reproducing tick reproduction. So, and that means, where does the female tick find a blood meal? The blood becomes eggs, the eggs hatch and become larvae, but the larvae are not infected. And so you need that second component. Where does it get its infection from? Everybody says it's white-footed mice, but it's also shrews, rabbits, squirrels, certain birds that spend a lot of time on the ground. They are known to infect ticks. When people argue about what the better stage is to target, I point out that with something like West Nile virus or Eastern equine encephalitis, we don't go after the birds that are the source of the virus and kill all the birds. We go after the source of the mosquitoes. Same thing, in my opinion, the same thing applies to Lyme disease. You go after the source of the ticks. Well, the odd thing is that if you look at the literature, there are all of these so-called infection rates published. X percent of the ticks are carrying Lyme disease bacteria. Those low numbers, 10 to 30% is actually pretty low if all the ticks feed on mice and all the mice are infected. You would conclude that all the ticks should be infected, but they're not, which means that the ticks are feeding on things other than mice. But the other thing is that when you go out there and walk through the woods, the probability that you'll come up with an infected tick is actually fairly high because if there are 10% of the ticks in a site that are infected, that means all you need to do is come up exposed to 10 ticks, and you'll be guaranteed to have one tick that's infected on you. And people have tried to use these numbers to try to predict how many cases of Lyme disease one might see. Fact of the matter is it varies from year to year, depending upon what animal is most common the year before. So in some years, white-footed mice are common. In some years, another animal that may not be infectious to ticks is common. And so the data that you see here is from Nantucket Island, where I spent a lot of time trying to predict how many cases would be there as a result of infection rates. The white bars on the left-hand graph are the infection rates for the ticks expressed as infected ticks per hour. And then the black bars are number of cases. And you can see there's no rhyme or reason there. There's no association between the number of infected ticks and the number of cases. And one of the big problems that we have is that if you go up to the right-hand side, if you look at the error bars around the infection rates, the bars actually going up the top go down at the bottom too, and so it means that from year to year there really is no difference. It's all around 10 or 15% of the ticks every year are infected. And that's why there's no predictive power to infection rates in ticks. So I provide these numbers simply as a base, as sort of for your information. The one important point here, though, is that Lyme disease spirochetes, the bacteria that cause Lyme disease, way more common than the other infections. Twofold, if not fivefold, more common than the other infections. And they're the ones that we really have to worry about. The Lyme disease is the most common infection. Now, one could say babesiosis or deer tick virus are more consequential to you. That is, you have a better chance of a negative outcome with them than you do Lyme disease. People like me like to go out and make observations and build graphs. This was some very early work that was done in trying to piece together the life cycle of the deer tick. You have on the left when patients appeared at Nantucket Cottage Hospital with babesiosis or Lyme disease, and you see a very pronounced midsummer, or most of the patients, 80% of them, come into the hospital around July. Mid-July is the peak. And then you go out there and you sample mice and you count the number of ticks on mice to get a handle on where the ticks, what time of the year the ticks are coming out. And you see that the nymphal ticks are out in May, June, July, and the larvae come out July, August, September. And so if you give the infections about 2 weeks of incubation period, that means there's no way the larvae could be contributing all of these cases. And that's consistent with what we see. The larvae are born uninfected. The nymphs are the ones that are causing that peak in the number of cases. And you'll notice there are very few cases on the left-hand side here in the winter months associated with adult ticks. The adult ticks don't seem to be much of a vector. They're not responsible for many of the cases, which is strange because they've had two chances to pick up infection. They feed as a larva, they feed as a nymph. And in fact, if you go out to the woods and you sample them and do infection rates, roughly 25 to 60% of the adult ticks are infected. So even though there's a high rate of infection in the fall and in through the winter and in the spring, you don't see a lot of cases. Well, why is that? It makes absolutely no sense, does it? Fact of the matter is, there's something called a grace period. Remember, the larval tick is feeding August and September. It has to wait until May or so to come out as a nymph and find another host. If you were a bacterium or a parasite in that tick, and you were eating up the resources of your host, you were taking the fat from your tick during those months, you would be impacting the fitness of your host. So it's been selected, the strains of bacteria and parasites been selected for that go to sleep during those months. And so they need to be woken up. That stimulus is warmth, that in particular, the ambient temperature in here, roughly 20 degrees centigrade. If it gets on your skin, that's a huge jump in ambient temperature to 37 degrees centigrade. That's the signal that tells them come out of your sleep. The blood coming in allows them to reproduce. So there's an extended duration of development in the tick once it's attached to you, and that's why there's a 2 to 3 day lag between attachment and transmission. That's the basis for the recommendation, remove the tick promptly. If you've had a tick on you for less than 2 days, the chances that you become infected are very, very small. It's not impossible, it's just very, very small. In fact, the original experiments, 1 out of 20 animals became infected if ticks were pulled off before 24 hours, whereas 20 out of 20 animals became infected when the ticks were pulled off at 72 hours. So that's the kind of experiment that needs to be done. Some poor graduate student stays up all night for 4 nights in a row, pulls ticks off every 6 hours, and then determines whether the animals become infected. That's how that experiment was done. And so we know for Lyme disease, spirochetes, it's 24 to 48 hours at the minimum. For babesiosis, it's even longer. They have an even more extended developmental cycle. And for the agent of granulocytic ehrlichiosis or anaplasmosis, maybe about the same as that for Lyme disease. The only fly in the ointment is tick-borne encephalitis virus or Powassan virus. It's instantaneously transmitted. So the tick takes 4 days to feed as a nymph. And all it's doing is creating a cavity in the feeding lesion so it can take a huge amount of blood on the last day, and then it drops off. So the essence of tickness is being able to take a big blood meal because it allows them to molt to the next stage, or it allows them to lay eggs. So this is the reason why adult ticks, despite their high infection rate, don't infect you, is because that's a fingernail up there on the bottom right. That's a fingernail, and that's a nymphal deer tick that's around from May through July. You're not going to see that. You're dressed differently. The ticks have a better, easier chance of getting up underneath your clothing. An adult tick is much bigger, and you're dressed differently during the colder months of the year. So here's the example where you have lots and lots of infection in ticks, but very few cases resulting as a result of the grace period, the way you dress, and the probability that you actually find the tick and remove it before the pathogens can get out. So that's sort of like a full course in the biology and epidemiology of these tick-transmitted infections in about 20 minutes. But you're here because you want to try to reduce your risk at the personal level, at the family level, at the community level. And this quote just, I was sitting in the audience at the International Lyme Meeting 6 or 7 years ago, and my fellow I worked with when I was a grad student, Joe Peisman, is now chief of Lyme disease vector studies at CDC, and he put this slide up, and I'm just going, you know, he's so right. We know how to kill ticks. We know how to prevent tick bites. We just don't know how to get people to do it. Everyone who is interested in reducing risk should have a copy of this tick management handbook. The Connecticut Agricultural Experiment Station in New Haven has it available as a free download PDF online. Just Google tick management handbook, it'll come up. And it has, it's you know, maybe 70 or 80 pages. It tells you everything you need to know about reducing risk for Lyme disease. On the other hand, you have very, very nice material here that if you learned and put in place would greatly reduce your risk of acquiring any of these tick-borne infections. I distinguish between modes of intervention, things that you can do at two different levels, at the level of the individual and at the level of communities. When we talk about personal protection, that's at the level of the individual and at the level of the family, and if you get blocks of neighbors together, maybe you all can do the same thing. Repellents and toxicants are a wonderful tool that you have. DEET-based repellents, there have been literally 500 million doses of DEET used in, since its invention in the 1940s, with maybe two dozen adverse effects. It's highly effective against biting arthropods, and I personally recommend something called Ultrathon. It's the civilian version of what our military uses. It's microencapsulated, which means that it stays on your skin longer. If you had a liquid form, it evaporates very quickly, but these microencapsulated formulations, they're on liposomes, and they're slowly released off the skin. The only big problem with Ultrathon is don't use it on your forehead. If you sweat and it gets down in your eyes, these little liposomes get on your eye and it hurts. It really hurts. It won't do anything to your eyes, it just hurts. Duranone or permethrin is used to treat clothing. It's highly toxic to ticks. It's highly toxic to most arthropods. You can treat your clothing. Our military uniforms all have permethrin coat impregnated fabric. Allegedly, you can run it through the wash 16 times and still have efficacy. That is, if a tick crawls on it, it will die within 3 hours. And so if I were really concerned, when I went to Siberia to work on tick-borne encephalitis, that's what I had on my pants because I didn't want to get bitten by ticks. And a lot of the literature says don't use it on your skin. That's simply because the companies are not willing to pay the money to do the clinical trials to prove that it's safe. The fact of the matter is, head louse shampoo, Nix, you leave on your kid's head for 10 to 30 minutes, has a higher concentration of permethrin than Duranone, the tick toxicant that you use on your clothing. So it's perfectly safe to put on your skin. It's just that it's not recommended because the FDA hasn't approved it. Appropriate clothing. There was mentioned in the film about tucking your pants legs into your socks. That's me. I look like an idiot, but I've been crawling around the bushes for 30 years now. I'm older than I look. And I have managed to avoid Lyme disease by this expedient, by this method of tucking my cuffs into my socks, and the other thing is my tick check. I go home, I take a shower that night, and I feel all over for bumps, new bumps. And using soap, you can feel for new bumps. And those two measures has prevented me from getting infected. I get many tick bites, but I find them and I remove them very quickly. Education and awareness. If you avail yourself of the information that is there and you follow the recommendations, you will greatly reduce your risk of getting infected. You may get tick bites, but that's a good tick bite if you recognize it, because you can pull it out, and if it hasn't been feeding very long, you really don't need to worry too much about it. It's not as if it's impossible that you would get infected. Those people who have cats, for example, outdoor cats bring ticks inside, the tick will feed for a while on the cat, get indigestion and get off onto you and start feeding. It may have been on the cat for that 24 to 48 hours, in which case it'll transfer to you and immediately transmit. However, you don't see that with dogs. The ticks like the dogs. They'll stay on the dog, they'll feed completely on the dog, they'll drop off and dry up in the corner of your house, or you'll squish them beneath your toes in the middle of the night. So dog owners are not at greater risk. We've always been puzzled about cats. Very early on, the first investigations of Lyme disease in Old Lyme, Connecticut, showed that there was an association of greater risk with cat ownership, but not dog ownership, and we believe that's why. The ticks just don't like cats and fall off. Habitat avoidance. If you have HIV or are on an immunosuppressive because of malignancy, don't go to Nantucket. Don't garden in your garden during June when the nymphal ticks are most common. Or dress yourself appropriately and use repellent as well as treat your clothing and be very religious about taking a shower and checking for ticks. You can reduce risk around your homes by clearing up. I hope, have heard about mosquito control around your homes. Don't have any standing water around, and this is the same thing that goes for ticks. Don't have places where mice can hide. Don't have places that can harbor ticks from the sun and the wind and drying out. So leaf litter, get rid of leaf litter. Clear back vegetation from entrances of homes, around the foundation of your house, and all of that. So all of that will greatly help. Now, I realize the long trousers and trouser cuffs during the middle of the summer, it's not going to fly with most people. And so if you can't do that, make sure and put repellent on your legs. That will take the place of not having to wear long trousers. I can't use repellent because I want to get the ticks. I don't want to repel the ticks, so I don't use repellent. What do you do if you do get bitten by a tick? Pull it out promptly. You don't need any fancy tools. Just use your fingers or a nice pair of tweezers and just pull it right out. Disinfect the site of the bite, wipe it with alcohol like you would a splinter or anything else. Save the tick taped to an index card with the date noted on it. If the tick seems to have some blood in it, like the bottom picture, you can see that it's a little more gray than the one up at the top. The one up at the top is a little flatter, doesn't have any blood in it. Take it and visit your healthcare provider, and that your physician or nurse practitioner may elect to treat you prophylactically, and we'll talk about that in a minute. If the tick is flat, it's hard to actually get a hold of. It's very unlikely to have been there for more than 24 or 36 hours, and most physicians will watch and wait. The probability of infection is very low, even if the tick is infected. I've had ticks on me as much as 28 to 30 hours, gone back to the lab, opened them up, they were hot, and decided to do nothing, and I still remain antibody free. Watch the site for an expanding rash or any fever within the next week or two. Now, the picture at the top, there's a slight reddish area around the tick. Is that Lyme disease? No. If the tick is attached and you see a red part, red skin underneath the tick while it's attached, that's not Lyme disease. That is a reaction to the tick bite. So don't panic if you see a rash and the tick is still there. If you see an expanding rash, and here's a nice set of pictures from Nantucket, most people are looking for the classic bullseye. Lyme disease doesn't have a classic presentation. What is classic is the expansion of the red area, if it moves over time. So a lot of conservative physicians will say, well, take a ballpoint pen and mark the edge of the rash, and if it's gone over that tomorrow, come and see me. If it hasn't, it's just a reaction to the tick bite. So the major feature is movement. That's where the name comes from, erythema, rash, migrans, moving. If it doesn't move, it's not Lyme disease. There is something called single dose or two tab doxycycline prophylaxis. If you get a tick bite and that tick is likely to have been on more than a couple days, that is, the tick is slightly fat, it has been shown in a peer-reviewed study that 200 milligrams, either two 100 milligram tablets or one 200 milligram tablet of doxycycline within 72 hours will prevent infection by Lyme disease. It's not known whether it would prevent the other other bacterial infections. Probably it would help. The other antibiotics, amoxicillin or the cephalosporins, are not known to have the same efficacy. So if you're really nervous about it and the tick is partially fed, you might be able to convince your physician to do this because there's good peer-reviewed evidence for it. So let's go back and review some features of Lyme disease ecology that's important for community-based action. That is seasonality. Larval season is less risky. So if you're worried about your children, go to Nantucket during September when only the larvae are out. 2-year life cycle. Any given day, they're in active stages hiding somewhere. Adult tick numbers in this fall and the spring don't necessarily predict risk during the summer. The spraying has to be done immediately before the entry of the new crop of ticks. So right now, or just when all the snow is gone, that's a good time to, sometime during early May is a good time to spray with a barrier treatment for nymphal ticks that'll kill the nymphal ticks that are just starting to emerge. You then want to do it in mid-July and August to kill the larval ticks that are coming out, and that means the next year's nymphal crop will be diminished by killing the larvae the previous year. This delayed influence is something that people don't quite understand. Daminics or tick tubes suffers greatly in terms of their commercial success because people don't realize that if you put tick tubes out today, it's not like you put bug spray on your tomatoes and you see nothing on your tomatoes tomorrow. That takes a long time for the effect to be seen. That is, you put the tick tubes out now, the nymphal ticks will fail to feed on mice and might mean fewer adults in October. You put the tick tubes out in July, it means fewer larvae feed on mice, which means fewer nymphs the following year. So that's a hard concept to market. So I told you we'd come back to this slide. These are the three factors that caused us to have this problem in the woods. Of these, what can we manipulate? What can we do to bring the landscape back to what it was before you had a problem? The only thing you can do is target deer. You can't prevent people from building in the woods. You can't say we need to chop the woods down again. So that's why at the level of communities, yes, you can do short-term things. Short-term meaning you do this year after year, if not season after season, the nymphal season, larval season, adult season. Short-term management where you can do habitat management. You can clear up the brush. And you can do this on a community basis. That is, if you have brush around a children's playground, get together as a community and clear it up. Get rid of leaf litter. Fire is a wonderful thing. Down south, there are sites where they burn every 3 years and there's not a tick to be seen. It clears out all the leaf litter and places for the ticks to hide. Desiccants, you can dry up the area by putting down stone or mulch and keeping it free of weeds and leaf litter that falls on it. You can use these host-targeted insecticides or acaricides, like the tick tubes, or you can have a version for deer where they come in and try to feed on corn and get covered with permethrin. But these are all things that require money and effort every single year, short-term approaches. The only long-term approach, returning the landscape back to what it was, is deer reduction, that is, reducing the density of deer. Just to reiterate, deer ticks require high relative humidity, shelter from wind and sun. Dry it out, cut the undergrowth, remove the leaf litter, apply wood chips, fresh cedar chips are probably the best, or stone, and mow frequently. If you have a pasture, mow along the sides. It's not your yard. It's the edge of the yard and into the woods where the ticks are. You need to spend about 6 hours on your lawn to pick up as many ticks in 20 minutes at the edge of your yard and 4 minutes in the woods. That's the gradient that you see related to humidity. The small animal hosts need places to hide. So if you have a wood pile, keep it away from your home. Remove undergrowth from around your foundation. Thin the canopy if you can. Promote raptors nesting around your yard. Landscape to reduce edge effects. Deer don't graze, they browse. They like the new growth on the shrubs. And so they need thick vegetation. They don't want to be out in the open all the time. So reduce places where they can hide. But none of it will be as effective over the long term, because there are things that require effort every single year, and people's effort just lag eventually. Your interest wanes. I make the case for deer with this slide. Most of the ticks in any site, it doesn't matter where the study was done, most of the adult ticks feed on deer, up to 90% of them. The tube at the bottom is 99 engorged female ticks from one buck taken at the Crane Reservation in 2004. I've seen anywhere from 0 to 300 ticks on a deer. Each one of those engorged females lays 2,000 eggs. And that tube is the harvest for 1 week. The ticks, the adult ticks, take 7 days to feed. So that is 7 days worth of ticks for one deer, and you have 8 weeks minimum during the fall for a deer, and then another 8 weeks in the spring. So one of the questions I'm interested in is, why aren't we up to here in ticks? Something is killing them. Something keeps their populations down low enough so that we don't see masses and masses of ticks. The picture up at the upper left hand is an egg mass. That's 2,000 ticks from one engorged female tick, and that's a deer ear with, I don't know, 15 or so adult ticks on them. So deer are feeding. They're the reproductive host. They're the source of the ticks. And one of the things I did as a graduate student for my doctoral dissertation was run an experiment down on the Cape where we reduced the deer herd from 35 to 50 per square mile down to fewer than 8, about 6 to 8 animals per square mile. You'll notice the precipitous decline in larvae on Great Island and the much slower decline in nymphs on Great Island. As a result, in our control site in Nantucket, we did absolutely nothing to the deer other than what they normally do every year, which is to take 200 by shotgun season. So the other thing was that I bled people every Sunday, third Sunday in July and August for a number of years, starting in 1984 or so, and then continuing to 1994. And you'll notice that there were cases starting retrospectively, we found probably in the early 60s, going until about 1985, and then 3 cases in 10 years after we reduced the deer. Now, to be fair, because we were out there all the time, people educated themselves, and that undoubtedly helped reduce risk. But I think the other thing was this. We used this numerical argument. It's a simple numerical argument. 17 mice per hectare by 100 larvae per mouse means that you're theoretically producing 2,000 nymphs per hectare. But the mice that are out there are only taking up about 25 ticks apiece, which means that they're only removing about 400, which means that there are 1,800 extra ticks being generated per hectare. After we reduced the deer, we still had about the same number of mice. We didn't do anything to the mice, but only 25 larvae on each mouse, which means we only produce about 400 ticks per hectare, the number of nymphs that are fed go down as well. 130 nymphs are being reduced, so we have only 300 extra ticks per hectare as a result of an 80% reduction in deer. So that corresponds to 80% fewer ticks. So that is why I argue very strongly that deer reduction is the only way to go for a long-term solution for Lyme disease. It's not a short-term solution. You kill deer today, you're still going to see plenty of ticks next year.
But you kill deer today for 5 years, we keep them down at a low level. 10 years from now, 20 years from now, our grandchildren will thank you. GIS analysis, if we take the reported case numbers for Lyme disease by year from the Massachusetts Department of Public Health website, we massage the data and plot in red those towns reporting more than 5 or 10 cases a year, we notice this very dramatic expansion in the distribution of intense Lyme disease transmission over the course of 6 years. I mean, that's pretty remarkable, going from the very focal areas in southeastern Massachusetts with little sites here and there, all the way to a almost complete red from central to the east to the Boston area. That is related, in my opinion, to this map on the lower left, which was published by Mass Division of Fish and Wildlife a couple years ago, showing towns where you can't effectively hunt by shotgun because there's a 500-foot safety setback from any inhabited home. So a new house that goes in takes away 18 acres of huntable land without permission from abutters. That is strongly related to the development of this problem, is we've let the deer come into our backyards and we're doing nothing about getting rid of them from our backyards. We have these alternatives that we do every year, that we can do every year. They're terribly costly. The so-called four-posters or treatment stations for deer. A bushel of corn needs to be put out every 2 weeks in this bin, and the paint rollers are there, and the deer come in, they get painted by these rollers with permethrin, and it clears them of ticks. They work very nicely. This paper was the result of a $5 million study by the USDA in 5 sites up and down the East Coast, and they show a 60 to 70% control of ticks that way. But it costs roughly $2,000 each of the stations, and you need one station for every 5 to 10 hectares in order for it to work. So a place like Nantucket is gonna have to spend $250,000 a year forever more if they just relied on the feeding stations. The other thing that this study demonstrated was by targeting the deer, you're reducing the ticks, which is proof that another form of proof that deer are responsible for the ticks. So we have all of these vector-borne infections in New England. We have ticks, we have fleas, we have mites, we have mosquitoes. One question most people don't think of is, where do mosquitoes come from? The man-biting mosquitoes that are the vectors for West Nile virus, for Eastern equine encephalitis, for La Crosse encephalitis, Jamestown Canyon virus, and Cache Valley virus. These are all fever-like illnesses that you can get from mosquitoes here in Massachusetts. This table is hard to read, but all you need to do is see the first 3 columns. Total number of mosquitoes that they tested, and those that fed on deer. The vast majority of mosquitoes that were tested for blood meals had blood meals from deer. Mosquitoes need blood to lay eggs. So the ones that bite you, the mammal feeding mosquitoes, get their blood meals from deer. We don't chain our dogs outside anymore. That's where a lot of mosquitoes used to get their blood from. And you're not out there very frequently either, all night. So that leaves things such as deer. So reducing deer is good public health because it reduces not only tick, but also mosquito densities. And the objective of deer reduction is not to eradicate the tick. We're never gonna get rid of this tick. If a neutron bomb were to drop on New England, it would be the cockroaches, the rats, and the ticks. They'd be left. However, what we want to try to do is go from a situation that, such as what we have on the left, big areas, blue areas. This is, you know, I made this up for Harvard a couple of years ago, but it applies here too. If these large areas where you can find lots of ticks, you can go through the woods and get 3 or 4 on your pants with no problem. What we want to do with deer reduction is clean it out so that you have little pockets here and there. And we can probably identify those pockets and put up signs and say, check yourself. So that's what the objective of deer reduction is, not to reduce tick numbers tomorrow or 5 years from now, but 20 years from now, back to what it was like. You used to have the situation on the right. There were ticks around here 10 years ago, 20 years ago. It's just that there were very few and far between. And you can reduce deer around your homes. If you think about it, you can get your police chief involved, you can work with Mass Wildlife, you can actually have controlled hunts to try to keep them out of neighborhoods. And you have to be vigilant, you have to keep doing it year after year to keep them away, but it does work. So, this is a whirlwind tour through personal up to community measures that you can take. We know what needs to be done, it's just a matter of getting you interested enough to do it. I hate to be cynical, but I've been working now for 30 years on Lyme disease and working with communities, mainly on the islands, to try to get them to do something. And only now do we start to see people becoming fed up. I'm happy to see the personal protective measures and other information out there for you to use, but it has to come from your heart, it has to come from the heart of the community in terms of how effective these measures can be. Do you want to make this place a better place for your children and grandchildren? Sadly, there's no such thing as a Lyme disease vaccine on the horizon. We had a very good one. I did my postdoc working on the mechanism of action. I ran the phase 2 clinical trial for it. It was a safe vaccine, it was effective, but activists believed that it gave them Lyme disease, threatened class action lawsuits against McKline Beauchamp, and the company at the time was not making enough money to warrant keeping the product around in the face of class action lawsuits, and they yanked it from the market. I would like to bring it back. It would cost us, I've been talking with a number of prominent citizens. We would need to raise $10 million to do the bridging studies to get FDA to reapprove it. But that's a drop in the bucket compared to the $100 million it would take to test and approve a new vaccine. So we have something that could be in place within 2 to 5 years. But it's unlikely that we're going to be able to come up with that kind of investment from the community. Yes, sir?
What about the vaccine that my dog gets?
Yeah, isn't that ironic? It's the same thing as the human Lyme disease vaccine. It's just that with veterinary products, there isn't a stringent safety and effectiveness.
So it's FDA, right?
No, well, FDA does not review veterinary products. But yes, FDA is the hurdle, yes. So I'm happy to stay here as long as you'd like and answer questions. Yes, ma'am.
You had mentioned before that if you see it take on you, just go ahead and pull it right off. I don't know if this is just a common misconception that I've read about, but I've been told that if you squeeze, and if it gets, like, you squeeze the blood and the transit goes back in you, you have a greater risk of getting the bacteria that's going to transmit that.
There's no evidence for that. In fact, there's what's known as a pharyngeal valve, permitting one-way travel of blood that is into the tick but not out of the tick. So it's unlikely that you would be able to squeeze to circumvent that valve. The other argument is, oh, you can't leave the head in. Fact of the matter is, the tick mouth parts don't have much soft tissue. It's mostly a tube. And that comes off pretty easily and it will rest in your skin like a splinter. It will be walled off as a foreign body reaction or it will work itself out just like a splinter. So there's no ill effect for leaving the head in, as it were. But I think there's no evidence whatever that squeezing the tick will promote delivery of bacteria into your skin.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you made the point very well that getting rid of the deer is a solution to the problem. Have you seen any place in the country where economics has come into play like a major market for venison? Or something of that nature?
We have explored that option on the islands. The islands are tough because there are only so many hunters that go out there and so many hunters on island, and the responsible hunters won't take more deer than they can use. And they said if we had an outlet, we would be able to take more deer and bring the harvest, you know, use the harvest as a means of controlling the deer herd. game managers now, there was a symposium at the Ecological Society of America, or Wildlife Society of America, back in October, where independently they came up with the idea of bringing back market hunting, a limited market hunt for deer. If you put a commercial angle to it, I think you would have a greater harvest. The big problem here is that the USDA and the FDA require that meat that is sold be read, the premises where the animal is killed must be readily inspectable. That's impossible for hunting. However, it seems to me there must be exceptions, and the thing that started me thinking about this in seriousness was that I was at a drug company dinner once in Atlanta at some hotel at the top of a building, and had Scottish grouse, and I chomped down and nearly broke a tooth on a shotgun pellet. And I'm going, what, we can allow Scottish grouse to be imported and they were killed by a shotgun, which is clearly not inspectable, but we can't do it here. What I need to do is convince our legislators, Markey and Warren, to put something into the Farm Bill that allows an exclusion of venison from that inspection provision. That's about the only way it's going to happen. Massachusetts, Department of Public Health, Aldo Maria, the state epidemiologist, says he has no problem with it. Venison's a healthy meat as long as it's processed correctly. But the state follows national regulations on food safety, and the national regulation is you must inspect the mode of killing. Yes?
You had venison in Europe.
Yes. Well, it, again, I
didn't know what venison in French meant, so I ate venison.
Well, the irony is that we import our venison from New Zealand, and we pay $20 a pound. Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. Are any traps, I mean, you know, giant mouse traps or cages that they can catch deer in? Don't require shooting?
We explored that option in this study that we did in the Cape in the mid-80s. And there are indeed huge box traps that can be used. But then the question is, what do you do with the animals? And when we said we want to relocate them, community said, not in my backyard. Yes, ma'am. Well, and that's where education comes in. Well, that's what I mean. The doctors need continuing education. It's a requirement of their license that they receive continuing medical education. The Department of Public Health would like to have continuing education modules for diagnosis and treatment of tick-borne disease. I was on the Governor's Lyme Disease Commission last year, and one of the recommendations we made was to provide DPH with the funds for a full-time educator so that this can happen. We've seen zip come out of that report. But you're absolutely right. If physicians understood that erythema migrans of Lyme disease doesn't have to be a bullseye, it just has to move, and if you treat it promptly, you avoid any of the more likely severe later manifestations. That is an important message that needs to be put out there. I think the Board of Health probably does some of that education. It can. It's just, well, co-infection gets a lot of press, but the fact of the matter is, if you go out and study the ticks, the proportion of ticks that have more than one agent is actually on the order of 5 to 10% at most. And I've only seen 1 out of 500 with 3 agents. So it's not as common. It can happen, and in fact, what's more important is that by virtue of the fact that you have Lyme disease, you have erythema migrans, that is proof that you have exposed yourself to ticks. What's to prevent you from having had another tick feed on you and infect you with something else? So our recommendation is, again, I'm not a physician, but I recommend as an epidemiologist to, when I talk to physicians, if you see one, you must test for the other two common ones, babesiosis and anaplasmosis. Yes, ma'am.
If you have Lyme disease, will it come back, or do you have to get again?
If you've been treated adequately, that is, you've complied with your physician's orders and you've taken your 3 to 4 weeks of oral antibiotics for early uncomplicated Lyme disease, there is very little evidence that the organism can survive that. However, the fact that you've had it once is proof that you have exposed yourself to ticks and are likely exposing yourself again and can get reinfected. So there's a lot of confusion. Is this relapsing Lyme disease or is it just another new case of Lyme disease? It's hard to tell the difference between the two. There are individuals who do seem to require more treatment than others, and trying to understand it is difficult. And then there's this whole chronic Lyme disease story. The fact of the matter is there are 3 different chronic Lyme diseases. There's chronic Lyme disease as a late stage disease. Someone gets the early disease, misses the rash, you know, maybe it's on the scalp, didn't see it, doesn't get treated, the acute flu-like illness goes away, weeks to months later you get a facial palsy or monoarticular arthritis, single joint arthritis. That is chronic Lyme disease. That's treatable. 95% of the time, one course of antibiotics is sufficient to treat that. Some people require 2 or 3 courses. Some may even require IV antibiotics. That's true chronic Lyme disease. Then there's chronic Lyme disease as in post-treatment Lyme disease. That is, people who get adequately treated, they take all of their pills, but they still feel not themselves for weeks to months afterwards. We're trying to understand that. We believe that it's sort of like being in a bar fight. Some people get up from the bar fight and the next day they're fine. Some people it takes some weeks to recover. Some people don't ever recover. Same thing with infection. It beats up on people in different ways. And so there's post-treatment Lyme disease, which is a chronic disease, probably not related to persistence of the organism. It's gone, but your body is still fighting it somehow, recovering from it. Then there's chronic Lyme disease where people claim they have vague signs and symptoms. As you saw, the very first slide I put up, fever, chills, muscle aches, fatigue, those are fairly nonspecific. You can have those. It doesn't mean it's Lyme disease. And a lot of people say, well, the tests are no good. The tests are actually not that bad. And so those are the ones that are even more interesting to me because I look at this list of 11 different tick-borne infections, I look at all the mosquito-transmitted infections, I look at the fleas and the mites in our yards, rabies and roundworms and things, everything else in your yards, I'm going, why can't it be one of those things? So there are 3 different things that could be talked about here. Yes, ma'am?
I have a question.
Well, if you're presenting with arthritis.
No, the symptoms of Lyme disease.
Early Lyme disease with the fever, chills, muscle aches, and fatigue.
Right.
And with or without rash.
Right.
Your primary care physician should be your first stop. But any of the large medical centers, Lahey, Brigham, Children's, Tufts, maybe even UMass Medical, they do have infectious disease physicians who should be able to tell what Lyme disease is. Should. And again, you know, physicians are human. They all need reminders of things sometimes. Yes?
I've been bitten several times over the years. And earlier on, my doctor would say, you know, send the tick in, and I'll send it to the lab and test it for Lyme disease. Unfortunately, it always came back negative. But what he does now, or most recently, I should say, is just prescribe a big dose of, one pill dose of doxycycline. Now, is there common places, if I wanted to see if that tick is infected with Lyme disease? Where would you
go? Board of Health has just initiated a program for that. Physicians won't, and the laboratory that does that testing makes it very clear. This is not a diagnostic assay. A physician can take the information with a grain of salt. They can decide to use the information or not. I do not recommend tick testing. What I recommend is evaluate how long the tick has been. If you think it's been on for more than a couple days, then see if your doctor will prescribe prophylactic antibiotics, especially if you're going there within 72 hours of finding the tick. There is peer-reviewed evidence that a single dose or two 100 milligram tablets will greatly reduce the risk of getting Lyme disease from that bite. Some people like the peace of mind of having the tick tested. That's fine, but it has no clinical, it has no evidence of clinical efficacy. Maybe. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that replacing the leaf litter with wood chips would reduce the ingression of ticks into your yard. Is the replacement of leaf litter with bark mulch equally effective?
Probably, as long as you kept it dry. If you let it age and get soaked with water, they may be able to survive in that. But I think pine bark, cedar mulch or pine, probably has two modes of action. One is that it's drier than the leaf litter, but two, there are chemicals in the pine bark or the cedar bark that the ticks just don't like. I mean, how many insects do you find in mulch anyway? You don't see a lot. There's something in it that kills arthropods. Yes?
If you have a fenced in yard, and obviously we have mice, little critters, but how do we get any deer? Is it likely that our yard is going to be infected with deer?
Yes, it will, because as you say, the little animals bring them in. If you had a huge property and you had a deer-proof fence, so if you have, you know, a 10 or 20 acre property, yeah, your home would be protected. Because as you come in further and further away from the fence into your yard, there are fewer and fewer animals traveling all that distance to bring the ticks and deposit them around your home. So fencing is not an option for the typical yard, but it is around communities, it's around states. Fencing has been demonstrated on a gradient basis, that is, near the fence you can find some ticks. 20 feet into the fence, you find fewer ticks, but they're still there. 20 feet more, you'll start seeing fewer and fewer and fewer. Yes, sir?
Has any study been done relative to global warming effects on the expected future population of the
species? Yeah, there are just as many speculations as there are with anything else. There's no data. And people can take data and make a case one way or the other. My personal feeling, given what I've seen crawling around for 30 years and noting that I do very poorly in collecting ticks when it's hot and dry, if the trend is towards hot and dry, that's good news for us. It means fewer ticks and probably a shorter duration of transmission season. It means our neighbors to the north will have what we have today, but will become much more like our neighbors to the south in Virginia and southward, where Lyme disease is not an issue. The tick has adapted to drier, hotter climates by hiding even farther in the leaf litter so that they're feeding mostly on ground-dwelling skinks, lizards, than they are on mice and other things. So that's my opinion, is that Lyme disease will become, and the other deer tick transmitted infections will become less of a problem with climate change. Yes?
Thank you very much for women on the clock. Is the vaccine more effective against infection than the prior infection?
Yes. There is no sterilizing immunity by natural infection. You can get reinfected. I have heard of individuals who've been infected three or four times. Sadly, they haven't taken recommendations for reducing their chances of getting bitten by a tick. You know, they didn't learn their lesson. But the vaccine is based upon a single protein on the surface of the bacterium that has been cloned and expressed in bacteria, and you get large quantities of it, and it stimulates a very strong immune response that you never see in a natural infection. And in fact, one of the reasons, if I've been successful in my career, is identifying how the vaccine works. Unlike most vaccines, which rely on what we call memory, you get killed measles virus, and then your body remembers having seen killed measles virus and gets fighting the real thing when you see it. The Lyme disease vaccine relies strictly on circulating antibodies, so you need frequent boosting to keep levels of antibody up in the blood. And what happens is that the blood, as it's ingested by the tick, is coming in with antibody and it's bombing the bacteria in the gut of the tick before they've had a chance to replicate and get out. So it's a very effective vaccine with that mechanism. So it's a very different mode of action, but one that's not seen in natural infections.
How often is it you have to be assisted?
The recommendation at the time was every year, probably every 2 years, but it varies from individual to individual. Yeah. But again, we don't have it. We, you know, the dogs can get it, but we can't. We don't have it. Well, it's a matter of using the test appropriately. It's inappropriate to test someone when they first come in with that flu-like illness. Your body has not had time to make antibodies, and therefore you'll be negative. Yeah. Similarly, if you come in with a flu-like illness and you're treated, your body may not have seen enough of the infection to create antibodies that will be detected, and therefore you'll be negative as well. So if you're treated promptly, you may be negative, even though you definitely had Lyme disease. However, those individuals who have later manifestations with facial palsy, or arthritis, or neurological issues, they almost always have antibody because the infection has persisted for a long time. Mm-hmm. If they don't, that would suggest to me that it's not Lyme disease.
So you should have a second
test? It depends. I mean, is there a reason to test if you come in with the expanding rash, you get your doxycycline, you take it, the rash goes away, and you feel better? What would be the reason to test? Other than your curiosity.
What if you have multiple rings on your body?
That's an interesting phenomenon. There's some infections. It may be a strain of the bacterium that disseminates faster. That is usually the bacteria in the skin where the tick deposits it. So the tick is not injecting it into a blood vessel. It's liberating it into subcutaneous tissue. And the bacteria replicating locally and then migrating at the lymphatics and sometimes into the bloodstream and moving from there to other sites. But this bacteria likes the skin. That's where the tick picks it up. And so the multiple lesions or satellite erythema migrans comes from those that disseminate very quickly from the bloodstream to other sites on the skin. So that's probably much more likely to give you a positive antibody test than someone with a single lesion. Yes?
How did you grasp this movement to get Bill Gates
$10 million? Well, you know, I've been waiting 30 years for him to play around at the Wisconsin golf course in Nantucket. Hasn't happened. Yes, sir.
How long do you have to have an infection before the antibody can be detected by a diagnostic test?
Usually 7 to 10 days.
Okay.
So you know, if you're
by that time, you should have had the doxycycline and it goes
right.
Away anyway.
If you've been treated, you recognize that, it may have aborted the antibody response. Yes. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, the town has an extensive trail system through woods, etc. So it sounds like I'm hearing you say widen them as much as possible. The whole trail system.
Go to 10 or 12 feet if you can, and make sure there's no leaf litter on the edges.
10 to 12 feet.
Yeah.
I know you can't recommend this because you're like unethical, but like, what's to stop me from taking the stuff I just put on the back of my dog and putting it, you know, on the back of my neck? Yeah. I mean, would I suffer? Or would I have this free of ticks as he gets?
But you can
walk from woods, we come out of the woods, and tick free, and I'm covered.
Yeah. But why does that work any better than repellents or urethrin on your clothing? Other than the fact that
I don't have clothing, I'm wearing shorts and a t-shirt. You know.
Well, but you know, mosquito repellent on your skin works just fine.
Really well. I've used that. It works really, really well. Yeah. It sticks, and I'd much rather do it once a month.
There are formulations that don't smell as much, and the other thing is you have to reapply it frequently.
I'm sorry?
You have to reapply DEET frequently unless you use one of these microencapsulated formulas. But you're right, it'd be nice to have something like that. But remember, not all of the spot-on or topical treatments for dogs are the same thing as what's been tested in humans. Permethrin, the pyrethroids have been extensively tested in humans. There's amitrex, fipronil, there's all sorts of other compounds that really we have no idea what the effects are on humans. So I wouldn't know that.
I'm not.
Yes, ma'am. There's no vaccine for Lyme disease that is available anywhere in the world. There is, however, a vaccine for tick-borne encephalitis in Europe. In Austria and Germany, every summer, at the start of the summer, there's a big media campaign, billboards, news, TV, radio, where they say, go get your boost for tick-borne encephalitis. It's an extremely important public health tool because the case fatality rate for Central European tick-borne encephalitis is 2 to 5%, and the majority of those who recover have paralysis or other lasting effects. So it's a really important public health tool there. But there is no Lyme disease vaccine available anywhere for humans. Osfeld has recently been on a paper where they're trying to approach of vaccinating mice so that the number of infected ticks is reduced in the environment. We at Tufts are also competing with them. We think we have a better one than they do. But that's probably 3 to 5 years down the line. And it's just one other tool. You can't have, there's no such thing as one magic bullet other than for the long-term solution of reducing your deer herd. You have to do things in combination. You have to use repellent with the tick check. You can't do repellent with no tick check. You've got to do both things at once. You've got to be aware that you're sick during the middle of the summer. You can't attribute it to your kid having a snotty nose. Go see your physician. Yes, ma'am.
Does the dog vaccine work on deer? We're very fond of our deer.
Yeah, we'd love to do some studies for that. Not necessarily for the infection, but rather an anti-tick vaccine to prevent them from reproducing on the deer. Working with deer is not easy. It would be a very expensive experiment, and I keep telling people, if some philanthropist were to hand me $1 million, that would probably be really up there on my list of things to do, because that would help. It would help. I've come to the realization after hitting the brick wall so many times, talking to communities about killing their deer, that we have to have other options besides killing deer. We have to use the four-poster devices. In fact, we're exploring on the vineyard now whether the Board of Health can pass local ordinances that say you cannot promote a pest. That is, if you don't allow hunting in your property, you must mitigate by doing something at your expense. I don't see why boards of health elsewhere can't do that. If there are known hazardous properties where the deer are, where there's no abatement of ticks, there's nobody clearing vegetation, it abuts a school, it abuts walking properties, why that property owner should not be held responsible. So you're right, we need other options, but right now we can't wait for a vaccine for deer. We know what can be done. We shouldn't just say, well, maybe in 5 or 10 years something else will come down the line. We need to act now. Yes, sir.
Is it practical to put contraceptives in the deer feeding stations?
There's a faculty member at Tufts who is working on that. Right now, the contraception chemicals that are used are not terribly effective. It's a huge effort, and so in this economy, when a community is faced with having to spend $5,000 or $10,000 to spay or neuter or chemically sterilize a deer, you know, a slug is a dollar. Yes, sir.
Do after having presenting symptoms of, say, arthritis or something like that, of course, one has antibodies. What's the best way to know if the infection is cured, imagining that there's no reinfection, and how long does it take with antibiotics?
Yeah, there is no test to determine whether you are cured, other than your signs and symptoms have resolved and you think you feel better. All the evidence from animal models, as well as long-term follow-up of patients who have had Lyme disease and been treated and have been educated about reducing their risk for tick bites, suggests that most of them get better within a month or so of taking their drugs. They will have antibody. If they have antibodies, that antibody could persist as long as 10 years. So the presence of antibody does not necessarily tell you whether there's active disease or active pathology or even active infection. It's just there. And that's not unusual. There are a lot of different, in fact, vaccines often rely on that. You can tell that you've been vaccinated because you take a blood test and you see that there's still antibody to that vaccine. So, but you're right, there is no gold standard way of determining whether you've been cleared of active infection with the tests that we have today. Yes, ma'am.
You said something about putting tubes around your property?
Yes.
Well, I don't know about that.
There's actually an example, the tube box over there under the neat scarecrow. That is something that was first called Daminex. And what it is the chemical permethrin. So permethrin and the pyrethroids are synthetic versions of what chrysanthemum flowers make, the pyrethrin. And it's highly toxic to arthropods. It's on cotton, so we spray cotton, put them in the tubes, and then the mice, you put the tubes out one every 15 foot of your perimeter, and the mice find the tubes, take the cotton back to their nest, it rubs off on their fur, and they become cleared of ticks, mites, fleas, and lice. And what it does is prevent those mice from making a group of infected ticks to sit in your yard. However, you need to do it twice a year. It typically costs about $600 a year to use this, but it does work. It is useful. It's a very friendly way of doing it. And I made a lot of enemies with my boss and his postdocs who invented this and erected the company when I went out there and told communities, you would not violate the patent if you got together as a community, bought cotton batting, coated it yourself with permethrin, dried it out, saved your toilet paper tubes, and made it yourself and tossed it out in the yard. You violate the patent only if you try to sell it. So again, it's, you know, you have these Earth Days and people go out in teams and clean up. Why on earth can the community come together and do things like that? Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned twice a year putting them out. When and recommend
every year
to them?
You have to do it. It's one of these short-term approaches that requires resources. So May and July.
Yeah.
Yes,
you
know.
Spray a lot of fertilizer, they also added the word ticks in there.
Mm-hmm.
Part of this. Now, how do you know whether that if you're really doing the tick spray, or is it just...
Do you see any other bugs afterwards?
Oh, I don't even
know
my lawn
anymore. Well, yeah, it's such a nice day today, everybody should have taken a walk. You shouldn't be afraid of the woods. There are things you can do to prevent tick bites. But spraying is not a dirty word.
Okay.
You can go to Home Depot and get something called Bug Be Gone Max Granular. It's a pyrethroid. You put it down as the label specifies around the edge of your yard and 6 feet in past the edge of your yard, not on your lawn. Maybe around the foundation of your home. That might not be a bad thing. The granular means it soaks down into the leaf litter and kills what's there. So it'll kill your spiders and woolly polies and everything else, but it definitely kills the ticks too. So you can get the stuff that the professional applicator uses
at-home needle. Yes, sir.
Is it safe to assume that the deer are suffering from Lyme disease as well?
No, actually they don't. People have done autopsies on deer and run them up the pathology and found no lesions whatever due to that they could attribute to Lyme disease. The reason is the mice, the ticks, and the deer have had this thing for probably 15 million years. They've co-evolved, they've co-adapted, they've gotten along, they've been together so long they've decided to get along with each other. We're relatively new to the scene, so we suffer the effects. In my field of parasitology, the study of parasites, it's an old rule that long-standing associations, there's a mutual evolution towards benignness on both parts. The host tries not to kill the parasite, and the parasite tries not to kill the host. But we've only entered the equation in the last couple hundred years. That's nothing. So we're suffering effects from that infection, but the deer do not.
Let's take a couple more.
We don't know the gene that's in the deer is protecting.
Well, we actually know the molecular mechanism. It's complement. It's a blood protein that all of us have. It's part of our what we call the innate immune system. And it just non-specifically kills bacteria. But the protein itself differs from animal to animal. And for some reason, the Lyme disease bacteria is susceptible to deer complement, but not to mouse complement or human complement.
So again, we can just have one or two more questions with Dr. Telford.
Has Lyme disease been transmitted from human to human animals?
There is a internet news in the last 3 weeks touting a study that was published in what I have to call a third-rank journal that claims to have tested husbands and wives and demonstrated that both, when one's infected, the other's infected. And the fact of the matter is, one, you have no way of knowing whether they share recreational activities. But there's just no evidence for it. We don't need to explain Lyme disease incidents by sexual transmission. Ticks are sufficient. Am I saying it never happens? Probably not. I mean, maybe it happens every once in a while, but this study was the laboratory who did the molecular biology, some of us suspect, sees things. So I don't believe that work at all. Yes, ma'am.
Does the rash go away if you're not treated or anything?
Yes.
What happens after, I don't know, how long is the period? And also, the other tick problems, is it the same? Rashes and
no.
Things, what is it that
that's why fever of unknown origin or summer fever is what you need to watch out for, not just the expanding rash, because the other four infections transmitted by deer ticks have no rash. So it's fever you're looking out for as the main thing to pick up on. The rash of Lyme disease will actually resolve on its own within 2 or 3 weeks without treatment. But then, weeks to months later, you may come up with a huge swollen knee, or with a facial palsy, or with problems in concentration. So you want to try to catch it at the rash if you possibly can, and treat it then.
Great. Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you.